Again, once again, good afternoon. Thank you everyone for being here today on such short notice. I'm here today to inform you about an investigation that's been going on with us for quite some time now, and it led to the arrest of Lodi City Council member Shakir Khan today at approximately 8 o'clock this morning. This investigation came to our attention in two different ways. One, through the current investigation against Councilman Shakir Khan that he's been going to court through that you all know about, and also by our private citizens here in San Joaquin County who have been concerned over our election process here in our county and in our state and in our country. And so they have brought some things to our attention that we acted on, and all this led to our final investigation here and the outcome today. I want to make it clear that this investigation has only uncovered criminal activity in our county here in a local election. It has nothing to do, it had no impact on any state or federal elections that we know of at this time. Our investigation uncovered that Councilman Shakir Khan has attempted to undermine, manipulate, and violate one of our most fundamental rights here in our country, and that is the right to free and fair elections. I would like to note that it appears Councilman Shakir Khan has targeted members of his own community, our Pakistani community in the North County, and we are doing everything we can to work with them to make sure that they are protected and that any damage done to them or their families is corrected by this man's actions. So I will be turning it over now to Captain Art Hardy and Lieutenant Andrew Theodore, to go through some of the stuff that I told you about that we have here, the evidence, and then I may interject myself in when I see something that I want to comment on that they're going through. So I'll turn it over to Captain Hardy.
Thank you, Sheriff. Like the Sheriff said, thank you for coming out today on short notice. This is a lengthy and complicated case, so we thought the best way to present it is to put together kind of a timeline and a slideshow to indicate our actions, why we took the actions, the next step of each action that we took, and the reason why we did that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the timeline, hopefully paint a picture, tell a story like you're kind of on a ride-along for the last roughly 3 years of this investigation. So it started back in 2019. We began to see a spike in criminal activity on the Waterloo Corridor in East Stockton. And some of the violent activity that we saw was, you know, robberies, assault with deadly weapons, there was even a homicide out there. So we tasked the team to find out what the root cause of that violent activity was and began an investigation to find out what was going on and if there was anything that we can do to restore order in that area. So as my team began to investigate and look into the matters of what was going on out there, they located a series of illegal internet gambling locations. These are locations that are set up in random buildings, back of stores and shops. Some of them were even set up in a garage of somebody's house. So we put together a plan to shut down these illegal gambling locations, and most of them complied. But there was one that refused to comply on a minimal action level, and that was the American Smokers Club on Waterloo Road. During our investigation, we found that that was owned by Shakir Khan. He is, as you know, a sitting council member of the city of Lodi. And as we began to do our investigative techniques, we looked into, you know, doing undercover operations, doing search warrants, things of that nature, surveillance on it, and we even hired a forensic auditor to look at some of the evidence that we were collecting. And there was indications that Shakir Khan was laundering money to Pakistan and had contacts down in Southern California. So we began to really spin up our investigation, try to put a stop to what was going on out there. And in September of 2020, we executed a search warrant on Shakir Khan's business, the American Smokers Club. If you look on the left over here, you'll see the search warrant that we issued, and that's how we made our way into the facility, and we were able to seize instruments and monies that were used for criminal activity. If you look at the lower right-hand side, you'll see an internet gambling machine there, some of the cash that was on scene, and up on top, there's even rules of how to behave while you're in there gambling. So after we saw that, we thought, okay, wait, does he have other stuff elsewhere? And so that's when we decided, you know what we're going to do? We're going to conduct a search on his residence. Does he have equipment over there, things of that nature? So we authored a search warrant and executed a search warrant on his home in Lodi. It's a modest three-bedroom, two-bath, 1,500-square-foot home. And we learned that it was he that lived there, his wife, his elderly father, and two juvenile children. Did he have a father-in-law or mother-in-law, do you recall?
That was father and mother.
Okay. So as we are going through it, we've located a box. And in the box, we found something that was highly unusual. We found sealed and completed ballots, 41 ballots in this particular box. And we thought to ourselves, that is weird. You know, it doesn't seem right to us, but we're not election people, okay? We do other types of crimes and things of that nature. But when we saw this, we thought, something's off here, but we didn't know if we had a crime at this particular point because there was a recent change in election law, and people could turn in ballots on behalf of another. There were drop boxes, there's multi-day voting, things of that nature. So we thought, you know what, let's just photograph them, leave them in place, let the election proceed unimpeded. So that's what we ended up doing. And during this time, around this time, we found that Shakir Khan was actually running for Lodi City Council in District 4. And ultimately, he wins that election, and in January 2021, he was sworn in and took his seat. But that didn't stop our investigation. We continued to investigate, and as we were investigating, we worked with the DA's office on what we were finding and issuing different warrants and things of that nature. And ultimately, Shakir Khan was arraigned. The DA pressed charges on him on our initial findings, and he was arraigned in court. And that's when, kind of hit the local news that a council member had been arraigned on fraud and internet gambling and money laundering and things of that nature. So that was kind of a big deal for us. And that matter right now is still pending. It's my understanding that the probable cause hearing just wrapped up, I believe it was yesterday, where he was held to answer on all the charges that were pending on that particular case. Now this is back in 2021. And during 2021, people were complaining around the nation, like the sheriff had said, about their concern with the way the 2020 election had been run and the shortcomings therein. And our county was no different, and we were aware of it, but we didn't have any proof or anything like that. We had some anomalies here that just seemed weird, but we didn't know if it was illegal because of the change in the voting law. So as the 2022 midterm election began to spin up, some concerned citizens continued to reach out. They would attend our local board meetings and voice their concerns and ask for a change back to the way things, quote unquote, used to be with one-day voting, in-person voting, no drop boxes, things of that nature. So they were very vocal at these board supervisors meetings, and as we attend those, we listen to what they had to say. Ultimately, a citizen contacted us and said, hey, I've gone through the voter rolls because I was looking into some of the stuff going on with my grandma. And as I was going through the voter rolls, I noticed some anomalies and some weird things, and I'd like to have a meeting. So ultimately, we did take that meeting. We sat down with them, and this person showed us the voter roll analysis that they had conducted. And sure, there was a lot of weird things that we saw in the voter rolls. Things that we didn't really understand were legal, not legal. It was just odd to us. But when she had pointed out a particular address in Lodi District 4, that's when it clicked in our head, wait a minute, that's Shakir Khan's address. Those are the 41 ballots that we saw. Is this legal? Is this proper? We don't know, but now we're going to look into it. And so ultimately, as we're looking into it, we located roughly 70 names that were registered to either Shakir Khan's house, his email, or his phone number that he had that we knew were factually his. And so that's 70 people that he was able to register using some sort of combination thereof. So through our previous investigation, we had access to his emails, and we did an analysis of his emails, and this is where we found on the one on the left is all the email receipts from the Secretary of State. When you go online to register to vote, you get an email response from the Secretary of State saying, we received your request to vote online or to register to vote. And so as you can see, these are all coming back to Shakir Khan's personal email that he used. The one on the right is just a sampling of the voter rolls that we saw of all the people registered to vote at that particular address. And so that became a little concerning to us. But again, is this illegal? I don't know. Because you have to understand is when we go to the academy and do all that fun stuff, at no point are we ever taught about the election code and things of that nature. So we stick to the penal code, the vehicle code, things like that. But we knew that there was a potential problem here, and if this was criminal, we were going to have to do something about it. And so while we educated ourselves on what the election code was, how to handle it, you know, what the violations, potential violations were, that's when we learned that every 2 years, the law dictates that the register of voter has to purge the previous election after every, I think it's 22 to 24 months, somewhere around there. And we were coming up to that timeline, and we were concerned that, hey, there might be evidence of a crime that is occurring here. And so what we decided to do, if we're going to bring this to court, if this is in fact criminal, we have to do it the proper way and adhere to the rules of evidence. So we executed a warrant on this register of voter to say, hey, preserve all documents as it relates to the 2020 election. Because again, we didn't know what we were going to find, if anything, but we wanted to make sure it didn't get purged. And I want to point out that the register of voter has been extremely helpful, forthcoming, and responsive to us. And I think that's important to note because, you know, something like this, just imagine the pressure that the register of voter and her staff are under when the sheriff's office shows up with a search warrant, right? But they were professional throughout the entire time, and at no time is the register of voter or her staff a target of this investigation. I want to make that very clear. So as we're going through the voter roll, and we got our own copy directly from the register of voter, we started going through it, and this is we pulled the ballot envelopes. And as we're going through the ballot envelopes, we thought, hey, something jumps out at us. I don't know if you guys can see it, but all the handwriting seems to be the same, right? Even looks like maybe even the same pen. We don't know. It's highly unusual. Again, is this illegal? Not necessarily, but it is odd. It is odd. It does give us some concern. So we decided we were going to look further into it. Now, if you recall, back in September of 2021, or was it September when he was arraigned?
Do you recall? January of 2021.
When he was arraigned by the DA's office?
It would have been January of 2022.
Okay. Well, when he was arraigned at the DA's office, he signed what's called a OR agreement, an own recognizance agreement. And basically what this is an agreement between him and the court saying that I agree to follow these sets of rules in lieu of being in custody while we fight this case, right? Because we're innocent until proven guilty. It could take some time. And so he agreed to these terms. And one of the terms was, if you look at number 5 there, he's not to leave the state or the country without the court's permission. Well, as we monitored the case, we became aware that Shakir Khan was posting on his social media website that he had left the state against his OR agreement. Now that's a felony. That could potentially be a felony in and of itself. So if you look on the left, that's his trip, a city taxpayer-funded trip to D.C. That he went on in violation of his OR agreement. If you look on the right, this is his social media, some snapshots from his social media page. Go back one. On his social media page, showing him in Hawaii, D.C., and New York. There's also indications he was down in Southern California, but that's still in the state, so that doesn't really qualify. So we said, okay, if he's violating his OR agreement, there's got to be something done about it. So we brought him back to court, told the judge, hey, he's violated his OR agreement, and so the court ultimately decided to put an ankle monitor on him. Now, as far as I know, this is the only sitting council member that we're aware of that is wearing an ankle monitor, so that's kind of unusual too. So we decided we're going to do a compliance check on Mr. Khan here. And so we went to his house to go check and see if he had any instruments of gambling or anything like that. And lo and behold, we find more ballots. This is in 2022, coming up to the 2022 election. Now, these are ballots. These are not filled out. These are not open. These are unopened ballots. But they're not for him, and they're not for his residents. Or some of them were not for his residents. That in and of itself, according to the election code, could be a crime. So, okay. Now we got some bigger issues here. So we started digging around a little bit more, and as we were digging around a little bit more, we came across his candidacy paperwork. And the one on the left is the American Smokers Club. You remember where he's running that internet gambling site? Well, during that time, as we were doing our investigation, he called his brother, who lived in Pakistan, who flew in from Pakistan to change the business into his name. And this was February 2020. However, on his candidacy paperwork on the left, if you notice, in July of 2020, he says he's the owner. So he tells us he's not the owner. He switches the name, but on his candidacy paperwork, he's saying he is the owner. So he's either intentionally misleading us or he's intentionally misleading the voters. Also part of his candidacy paperwork is a pledge, basically, that you make to say that you're going to run an ethical campaign. And right here, this is the pledge that he signed and says, I will run an ethical campaign. But this is where it gets interesting. We get a hold of his candidacy paperwork where, as running as a public official, you have to gather signatures of registered voters that live in the district that you're running in. And so we got a hold of that. And we're looking through it, and as we're looking through it, we notice the name on there, the name of his brother. Well, that's strange because his brother doesn't live here. His brother lives in Pakistan. And we know that his brother wasn't in the country. We have facts that the brother was not even in the country at the time that this document was signed. So how did he sign it if he's not even here? So we began to scrutinize the document a little bit more, and that's when we found a name that was generally a common spelling name that was misspelled. And we're like, that's strange. I misspell a lot of things, but I don't know if I've ever misspelled my own name. So we looked at it. We looked into the DMV database. We compared the signature that was in the DMV database to the signature that's on this form here, and they didn't match. So like, okay, now we got two potential things of forgery going on here. So we scrutinized the entire document. Went through the whole thing. And all the highlighted sections there are ones that we indicate or that we have belief that those are forgeries. Now, this is problematic for Shakir Khan because when you submit this document to the Register of Voter, you submit it under penalty of perjury. And here is where his signature for penalty of perjury that this document is true, accurate, correct, and that he signed or he witnessed somebody sign each and every one of those things. And we know that not to be true because, number one, there was several misspellings, the brothers in Pakistan, things of that nature. So we've got ourselves a potential case here. So in order to verify our findings, we have to go out there and talk to the people. We have to canvass the area to say, hey, is this your signature? Did you vote? Things like that. But we didn't want to come off as being authoritarian or anything like that. We wanted to say, hey, listen, we're just out here doing a fact finding. I instructed my team when they went out there. Nobody's a target of the investigation. We're not looking to open up criminal charges on anybody that we talked to. We just wanted to get to the fact. So we developed a questionnaire. And part of the questionnaire goes through all this stuff. And they were instructed at no time were they supposed to mention anybody's name. Now, if somebody brought up the name themselves, that's on them. That's fine. But we're not going to influence anybody and bring up names and things of that nature. So now what we have is we have a series of videos, and I'm going to kind of narrate a little bit of the video. We'll play it. They're real short, but it kind of gets to the meat of what we found out there. Now, this is just a sampling of what we found. We have more videos and things of that nature. So
guys, real quick, I just want to interject that we're going to show you these videos. They're from our body cameras. We're understanding that the sound quality on this is not going to be good. It's going to be difficult for you to hear what the other people are saying. We thought about putting subtitles on it or something like that, but we didn't want to risk people saying, oh, we changed what they actually said or something like that. So we're just going to give it to you as it is. At the end of this, as I said, we'll let you hear it as it is here. And everybody that we interviewed, our guys had the body camera footage on, and as Captain Hardy said, our goal here was to make them feel comfortable and safe and know that we're trying to do the best thing for them and take care of them and make sure that they're not victimized any further.
Okay. So each of these videos is going to show some element of intimidation, unauthorized use of another person's identifying information. There's some privacy concerns. When you vote, you're supposed to be able to vote in private. That's why we all go in a booth and it's just us in there. There's also some indications of fraud. So the first video, this is the subject that we found the misspelling on. okay, that signed the candidacy paperwork saying, I support Shakir Khan for running for Lodi City Council. Go ahead and play the video.
So this is going to be the highlight portion. So this is the print and signature.
No,
that's not your signature? The highlight portion is not. I got you. It's just so that's it.
So this next video is where Councilmember Khan essentially pressured the voter to vote one for me and one for Biden.
And then you signed it? Did he explain to you what it was exactly that it was filling out on the ballot?
Biden?
So in this next video, we'll show you how Councilmember Khan pressured people so he can register them to vote, basically telling them, quote, I need your vote.
She said he took her ID.
Why?
He said he needed her vote. Yeah.
Okay.
Did he take her ID and keep it?
So this next video will show how Councilmember Khan took advantage that many didn't know the process of voting, and so he kind of stepped in and took advantage of them.
Is this your wife's email?
No, this is Shakir. I don't give the picture of my wife, everything.
Oh, okay. No, what about the phone number?
This is about him.
These are both Shakir's?
Yes.
Email and phone number?
Yes.
Okay, so she never put that on anything?
Nothing.
Gotcha. So yes, Skin that wrote it?
No. Nothing. She only, he said, give me your ID or whatever.
Uh-huh.
So he can register for her and everything.
So in this next video, Councilmember Khan had people sign ballot envelopes after he had already completed the ballot himself. He brought them over to their house and had them to vote. What's interesting, or sign the ballot. What's interesting about this is this particular one, this person didn't even live in the district. They were re-registered to Khan's house to vote in that district. So, go ahead and play that one.
I think you know that by Shepard.
Okay, the councilman?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I think he helped me out. I'm not sure.
He helped you?
I think so.
Okay. Do you remember, did he come to your house and help you, or did you go somewhere and help you get registration? You don't remember? You think he helped you?
Yes.
Okay.
Because he was the asking for more for the
time. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Hey, you're not aware of that address? And
when those elections happened,
mm-hmm.
The city elections, he called me. I went up there and he had my vote.
He had your ballot?
Yeah, I think I just signed and
Did you fill it out? The ballot? Or you say, who you say he did?
Shaq
did? So he had your ballot?
He did.
And then he gave you, and you fill out the actual, because it will be like, oh, you open the ballot, there'll be forms, you check who you want, and then you seal it.
I remember I signed it.
You never signed it? Okay. Just the closed envelope? You signed that? Okay. And what year was that? Was that 2020?
That's when the city that came.
Okay. 2020.
In this next video, we'll see how Councilman Khan physically filled out the ballot of another in their presence. So if you remember, you're supposed to have the right of privacy when you vote.
Like say his name is on there? to vote for, and you bubbled that in?
Bubbled that in.
Was he there for that?
He was there for that.
Okay, so he was there for the ballot. It's totally understandable.
Yeah.
So
he filled out the
ballot? He filled it out, yeah.
He filled out the ballot?
He filled out the ballot.
Oh, wow.
Okay. In this last video, we'll show how Councilman Khan victimized the Pakistani community and used their personal information without their consent for his personal gain.
You know where this phone number would be on your registration?
He did help me with the your ADD thing, but okay. I didn't give him any permission to use it. Use his email my voter registration or anything.
Though. Okay, and who is that?
It's Shakir Khan.
Shakir Khan?
Yes.
So he helped you fill out your EED report?
Yeah. Yes, he did.
Okay. But he didn't help you fill out your voter registration?
No.
And one last question. So you never allowed him to put his email or his phone or this email or this phone number, which might belong to him, on your registration?
For voting, no.
No permissions?
No.
So, again, this is just a sampling of 7 different videos. And I think it kind of demonstrates how Khan took advantage of other people for his personal gain, because he was on the ballot and he was running for election. And ultimately, he won that election. So, after we had talked to these people and canvassed the area, and the word, I guess, got out, and Councilmember Khan found out about it, and he decided he was going to take to social media and post a video. The video is in his native language of Urdu, and we find it a little bit concerning that after we're talking to these people, he comes in behind us, specifically directing it to the Pakistani community of Lodi, and saying, if you look at the highlighted or the black portion there, if someone or anyone comes, tell them that you did the vote yourself. No one helped you fill out your vote. You use your own right to fill out the vote in your own hands. We just showed a bunch of videos and we talked to a bunch of people and said that is not true.
Yeah, I don't know about you guys. I'm going to interject here. It's infuriating to watch this. You see these good people. You can hear their children in the background. They're here trying to make a better life for themselves and this family. And here a member of their own community is taking advantage of them. And then he goes online and speaks in their native language to tell them to lie to the police and to cover for him. It just goes against everything that we stand for here in our country. And it's maddening every time I watch it. So we're going after this guy, and we're doing what we can to make sure we get justice for these families.
So bear with me, I'm almost done. I know I'm a little long-winded here, but I'm trying to paint a picture here. So based on all this information, all the investigation that we've done, as you know, we worked with the DA's office, submitted the case to them. They agreed that there was sufficient evidence to move forward in the case, and they issued an arrest warrant for Shakir Khan. Here's a copy of the arrest warrant. Those are the charges that are on the arrest warrant. He was set at no bail, and earlier today, this morning, we took Mr. Khan into custody based on the arrest warrant. Ultimately, he was booked at the county jail, where he's booked on, again, these following charges that are on the arrest warrant itself. We're actively working with the DA's office on this particular case. We have some other outstanding warrants that we're waiting for a return on. They indicate, based on the results of those returned warrants, there may be additional charges pending against Mr. Khan. So now that we've kind of educated ourselves a little bit about the voting process and things and taken a look at the voter rolls, we did notice some issues in the voting process, to no fault of the registered voter herself or her team, but just the way the voting system is structured. We see quite a few flaws. You're able to register even if and cast a vote if you don't live in the country, as evident of his brother in Pakistan. And I think we have some evidence of 2 or 3 other people out of the country that voted. Is that correct?
Yeah, approximately 2 or 3 other people out of the country, as well as people residing outside of the district.
Okay. The online voter registration system, it seems to be an honor system. Anybody can put information in there to register to vote. All you have to do is click a box and say that you're not lying, and then you'll get an email from the Secretary of State or something in the mail saying thank you for registering to vote, and there you are. Once you're on the voter rolls, anytime an election comes around, guess what? You get mailed a ballot, right? You get mailed something to vote. So we found that a little bit problematic. And then there's an issue of signature verification. So on Khan's candidacy paperwork, we noticed several forgeries on there. And when we compared it to the DMV database, they were not accurate. So, you know, we're kind of working with that to find out where the flaw is in that particular issue. People, like Lieutenant Theodore said, people can re-register to vote in a district that they don't actually live in because you could do it all online. There's no checks and balances to say, yes, this person did move or anything like that. Again, an honor system. So some of the anomalies that citizen that called the meeting with us pointed out, they noticed that there were about 93 people that were registered to vote or on the voter rolls. Whether they cast a ballot or not, we're not going to get into that. Just the fact that they were on the voter rolls with the birth date of 1850. There were 232 people registered to vote with an address to our local prisons. There were 4,144 people that were 90 years old and older. There were 125 people registered to vote or on the voter rolls that were registered to, or their address comes back to, nonprofit, NGOs, and different businesses. There were approximately 300 people with no first name, just the last name. There were about 110 people that were possible double voters, basically the same name, date of birth, address, but two different voter ID numbers. People were registered to vote at various shelters and all that. And we even found one person on the voter rolls by the name of Jesus Christ, which we found kind of interesting. Again, none of this proves that there's wrongdoing or anything like that, but that does indicate to us that we kind of need to take a closer look at what our voting system is looking like out there. And we're working closely with the Register of Voter. We've brought up these issues with her, and she's addressing those on her end, and we're kind of developing a plan, because our ultimate goal is to restore people's faith in the voting system. And so, you know, we're creating a relationship with her, and a lot of times people come to us and they say, hey, you know, what can we do? Well, my recommendation is create a relationship with the Register of Voter, with your local sheriff, with your board of supervisors, you know, with your DA, and just make sure that your county, whatever you live in, is secure as much as it can be.
All right, thank you, Captain. Thank you. So again, we want to reiterate the fact that our Register of Voters, we're very fortunate here. She has worked closely with us. She has taken this information, and they're working diligently, and may have completed the review of the voter rolls already and correcting the items that we have brought to their attention. Again, this case did not happen because of anything that our local Register of Voter could do to change that. That was a state system that he took advantage of and registered people that didn't even know they were being registered. So. Here, we're confident in our Register of Voter and the way we do things here, and we know that we will continue to monitor this and hold anyone accountable in our county or anywhere that we find them that is violating this sacred trust that we have here in our country. And just know, if you try this in our county, we're coming after you. And we continue to look at anything that comes our way, whether there's double voters. We've gone out on several of those and found that there was some legitimate thing where some elderly people didn't remember mailing in their ballot and tried to show up at a voter thing and things like that. So things happen. We're just looking for bad guys intentionally trying to take advantage of stuff. So we're going to open it up to questions. Olivia Hale's here from the Register of Voter. If you have questions that we can't answer, and we'll see what we can do. Yeah.
So just a couple of clarification things. First, what does laundering money to Pakistan mean? Is this money coming from Pakistan, untraceable money from Pakistan to America to become clean?
Yeah, I believe it's the other way around, but I don't know if Lieutenant Theodore handled it.
Yeah, so during the initial investigation, we had forensic auditors take a look at his bank accounts related to the illegal gambling investigation and discovered a significant amount of money being sent to banks outside of the country that were tied to illegal gambling proceeds that he had made as a result of his illegal gambling venture.
Is there a federal investigation? Has this been referred to any federal investigators as a result of that?
There have been federal entities that have been involved in the investigation, but I can't speak to the extent that they're currently involved.
Okay. And again, this case today is about the voter fraud. Mm-hmm. The other case is currently in court, and we don't want to do anything to jeopardize that, so we can't speak too much on that. The DA was offered to be here today, DA Ron Freitas. He's done an amazing job. His first few weeks in office, he got a case that's been sitting for 2 years and got it to prelim, and that's Shakir Khan's first case, the one you're asking questions about. And he's immediately jumping on the information and assisting on this one also.
Okay. I was just trying to understand, because also when we're talking about voter stuff, you know, are we talking about potentially federal crimes here as well?
You know, maybe Ms. Hale can address that. I don't know if they would be state charges or could there be federal charges?
Federal election, there could be federal charges involved. That is very possible. You know, tampering with an election is a federal crime, so we could see what that becomes as this progresses.
And has this been referred to the Secretary of State's office in California?
Yes, they're aware.
Okay. And just while we have you up there, Mr. Real quick, because I do have another question for you, Sheriff. But we actually similarly had some questions recently about a city council member in a different city, but with some questions about what they put on voter forms and, you know, where they actually lived and just how that information comes down. And having gone through this process with the Secretary of State's office and, for example, the Sacramento County Registrar, a lot of the information we were given is that a lot of it comes down to the Registrar's office in terms of verification that, you know, if someone puts an address, that the address is supposed to be checked, that it's local, and that signature verification happens there at a local level. So can you talk to us about what you feel the San Joaquin County Registrar's Office role is here and responsibility, if at all, for what happened?
So any paper filings would be our responsibility, as the Sheriff's Office has shared. These were online registrations done with the online registration process through the Secretary of State. Those forms were then forwarded to our office, and there is a verification process. But it looks as though it appears that there's been a workaround of that process, and so now we're going to actively have to look into that and what we can do going forward.
So did these come through, these online forms, did they come through their office and did they get the go-ahead from your office?
They came through as online registrations, so they are in, they're put into a state database called VoteCal and then brought down to our system, and then the verification process is simply verifying that there's a driver's license and a four-digit social security number, and if those are present, then they are able to move from the pending status into active status.
So just whether or not they exist, not whether or not it matches, like not a signature or anything like that?
When they do the online application, they don't provide the signature. The first signature we're going to see is that first mailing that we receive back from them. So that's part of it. And then sometimes we get information over of a signature on a DMV application, but we only receive those if a voter goes to the DMV and checks the box saying, please update my registration. Then we're allowed to see that image. We don't get that image unless that box is checked at DMV.
Just one more.
Can I drive that point home really quick, though? I don't know if you caught it, but so if you register online, put your email address and everything else that we saw that Councilman Khan was doing, then they mail him that ballot. The first signature either the state or local sees is the him signing it. So if he registers Pat Withrow and writes Pat Withrow, from now on, that's going to be Pat Withrow's signature every time they check it in there. Mm-hmm. So if you don't know about that, if I didn't know about it, the signatures would match because he's writing them every single time. Mm-hmm. So clearly that's something at the state level we need to look at and make sure that nobody else takes advantage of this loophole.
And Ms. Hall, just one more question. I'm not sure if you know this off the top of your head. I recognize this information is cataloged online. But off the top of your head, do you remember how close his election was? As I know, a lot of the discussion about voter fraud is not whether or not voter fraud exists, but whether or not it exists in a meaningful enough way to influence the outcome of an election. Is what we're talking here, would that have changed whether or not he was elected?
It was the 2020 election when this occurred. If I look back, I I don't know what the margin was. You guys remember what it is?
I can tell you, because that's a very smart question, because I asked that same question. And I believe we found out that it, a couple hundred votes, or something like that.
He was determined to have won that election by approximately 220 to 230 votes.
Yeah.
So just, and I recognize this is a subjective question, but just based on your experience and your investigation here and these interactions that you've had with the community, do you think this made a difference in him being elected?
I do. I think it made, for my opinion, if you're asking, yes, it did. Clearly, he was out influencing people unethically and illegally. Clearly, he submitted his candidacy forms, which were not legitimate, so he should have never been on the ballot in the first place. And I think there's no question in my mind that that influenced the outcome of this election, and that's why this morning after we took him into custody, we met with the city manager of Lodi, the chief of police of Lodi, and they got with their legal counsel, and they're starting to look into all the ramifications that may come from this illegal activity.
How much of what we saw on camera was actually a crime? For example, is telling someone to vote for someone a crime? Is saying, if a person has a ballot saying, mark me and mark Biden, is that a crime to tell them to do that?
It's influencing their vote, and so every voter has the right to privacy to vote their choice. And so if you are forcing a voter to vote for you, then yes, that's absolutely a crime.
I guess what I was saying is there an indication that he forced them? I mean, I feel like a lot of this, and I recognize we might be talking about lying here, but a lot of this is what candidates do going around door to door every day. Hey, when you fill out your ballot, make sure you mark my name.
Yeah, I would disagree. These are two different things. Yes, candidates, and I've lived this for 8 years. Yes, we go around and we ask people to vote for us, and we tell them why we think they should vote for us and the difference we can make. But you saw those videos. These are victims. These are people that he took advantage of, people that did not know the system, had no idea what he was talking about, was clearly intimidated by a man who's in a position of power over them. And does anyone in any situation, a council member is or a person running for seat who is going to be in a position of power, are you new to this country or ever, however long you've been here, are you going to tell that person no? Are you going to tell them you're not going to? No, don't vote for you. We had one guy go, I didn't even vote for him, and yet his ballot said that he did. I think it's very clear, and it's very clear for anyone that runs for office. You are not to attempt to influence or intimidate in any way, and you're certainly not going to be filling out their ballots and forcing them to sign them and all those type of things that occurred here.
I'd like to make a clarifying point. That person that stated that they voted for the opponent, we didn't have their ballot. That's what they told us. They told us, I voted for the opponent, not for him. This is the one where his name was misspelled on the candidacy form, and we verified that the signature did not match.
Sheriff, quick question. Sorry, I came in late. What made you focus, I see 2019, what made you focus on Mr. Khan?
We spoke about it earlier, and what it was is we had some citizens come forward and show us some anomalies on the voter rolls, and we recognized that address from his being arrested on our previous case as being his house, and that brought it to our attention. And then there was a second part. There were two parts that brought it to our attention.
Yes.
Oh, and when we went to his house, I'm sorry. When we went to his house, that caught our attention also. We saw that top picture is when the first time we went to his house and all those ballots were there. So these two things brought it together and said, hey, we possibly have a crime here. We started working closely with the Register of Voters, securing those ballots back from 2020 so that we could have time to conduct our investigation. And then we went through and found all these anomalies through him.
Did he offer any excuse or reason as to why he had all those?
Today during our arrest, we did not question him regarding this case because of his ongoing case, and he has an attorney for that. We did not question him about any of this information here.
How close to the election did you find these ballots?
This was...
We found these, I believe, in October of 2020, and then when we did the compliance search for the OR,
What month was that? October of 2022. Yeah.
So we found the first ones in October of
2020.
So that was after, it was before the November election. So.
Are they mailed 3 weeks ahead of time, or is it 2 weeks?
They're mailed 29 days prior.
29 days prior, because they've been out for a few weeks. Recognizing this happened in such a short period of time, was there any possibility, because I recognize also that some of the headlines had already come out about him, but was there any possibility of telling the voters that ballots had been found in the home of the candidate?
Well, we always try and err on the side of caution. We know that nobody's life was in danger here or anything like that. We knew we were going to be able to come back and investigate more thoroughly. And hopefully, if there was some wrongdoing, as we have done now, try and correct that. But if we'd have come out and accused someone falsely and then altered an election because of that, I think we've seen accusations of that on a national level. And so we just tried to err on the side of what was right, and that knowing that we could take action later is the way we handled it.
Question for Rooster. What happens to the vacancy now at the city council?
That'll be determined by the city clerk's office and how they'll so how municipal elections work is the city clerk is the filing official for that election, so they're responsible and they are the elections official for the city jurisdiction. So all that will be dictated by the city, and then the city may determine that they need election services, and then they hire our office to conduct their election for that.
And let me correct the premise of the question. That position is not vacant. He is still a councilman in the city of Lodi. Just this morning, we alerted Lodi that there may have been an issue with this election and the legality of that. He will still have to go through the court process to see what charges he is found guilty of, if any. And so he will continue to be a councilman unless they take action to have him removed somehow. But as we handcuffed him and placed him in the car this morning, he was still a Lodi City Councilman.
And, Sheriff, what is he looking at as far as, if these charges hold and he's convicted?
Wow, I think there could be substantial vulnerability here for him. I think it was 14 federal charges, 12 felony charges, something like that were on there. Don't hold me to that. We'll get you that information, the booking slip. And then if the feds want to step in and take this federal, there are always huge consequences on those. But I don't know exactly the years that we're looking at. But I would hope that he would be held to the highest level of accountability on this when it comes, if he's found guilty of these, to send a message to anybody throughout our state or country that thinks about doing this again to infringe upon what so many people have died for in our country, that they would send a message and set an example on this that do not mess with our elections.
In all your years with the Sheriff's Department, have you ever heard or come across a case such as this one?
Well, to be honest, it's not that many years, okay? But no, I have never heard of this or seen this. But I can tell you, it was very eye-opening. It's shocking to us, and we're going to work closely. We've got a great partner here at the Register of Voters who has done everything we've asked and more, and has done everything that the community has asked. I don't know if you're aware. Maybe some of you took the tour and stuff like that at the last election, and the transparency that they're showing there. I think we're a model for the rest of the state on what all the ROVs should be doing, working with their community, and taking every concern from every citizen very seriously, and addressing it and getting them the answers they need.
One more.
Yep.
Being that he violated his OR, would he be eligible again for bailing out?
Well, it's a nonviolent crime, so yes, he could possibly bail out again. There's many things that can happen. If you're asking my opinion, I think he should stay in custody. I think clearly he's shown no respect towards the court, but that's just my opinion. This is up to a judge, and a judge can say, let him back out, and we've seen that in many, many other cases that is frustrating to us sometimes. But it is a nonviolent crime, so, but it is such an egregious crime, I hope they don't let him back out.
But would any of this have occurred subsequent to the other things that he is currently facing charges for? So would this be considered, for example, if he's out, you know, with the ankle monitor, would this be considered a violation of that?
Yeah, if you commit another crime while you're out on an OR, I believe Captain Hardy touched on that before, it's another crime. You can't violate any other laws while you're out.
I guess what I'm trying to get at is, did he commit another crime, or did he just get caught for a crime he had already committed? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. These things were signed back in the day, and
so if you recall, when we did that compliance search on his OR condition, we found more ballots. And depending on what he was doing with those ballots, how he had them, that could also be a crime.
So the fact that ones, yeah, the blue ones down
yeah,
there.
Not those, there's a different set. But also, leaving the state itself was a crime. Mm-hmm. So.
But they let him out on that one.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. All right, anything else? All right, you guys, again, thank you for coming on such short notice. We really appreciate it, and we'll keep you updated on anything further. And if anybody else finds that they have been victimized or think they may have been victimized or have concerns or any information regarding this case, if you could give us a call here at the Sheriff's Office, it's our main line, 468-4400, and hit option 1, because we have a tree that's really annoying. So 468-4400 and option 1. That will get you to the right place to let us know if you have any further information on this. Again, thank you all for coming.